Jesus makes intercession for us to the Father. Then comes this great statement of Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. So come on in, have your way. My Savior and my friend.
All right, good morning and welcome to Lima Baptist Temple. Welcome to our Gone Country Month. Let's go ahead and stand up together and let's go ahead and start off with worship this morning. Singing, you may be seated.
Morning, beloved. You may have a seat if you can. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. This morning, I'd like to share a very familiar story with you. A few years back, a young lady went off to college.
Great. Here we go again with that story about the elephant. I mean, don't you have another story to prove your point? I've heard it like 3 times this year already. And you know what? It's not even that funny. Yeah, I said it. Not even funny. Maybe I should fill out one of those comment cards. It's not like I'm asking all that much. I come here every Sunday or so for some coffee, fellowship, and to hear a new message. The least you can do is make it fresh and insightful and funny and moving and theologically sound and historically accurate every week. Maybe I am asking too much. Probably way too much. I mean, Pastor did visit Joe in the hospital and celebrated with us when Michelle was born and was there when Susan lost her mom and encouraged me to fight for my family when we were on the brink of separation. Now that I think about it, Pastor's been like a counselor, mentor, and a friend when I needed it the most. Pastors are awesome. Go ahead, Pastor. Tell that story again. I'll even laugh this time.
Maybe I don't know.
He's like a clown.
We love you, Pastor Owl.
Two.
80.
10.
28.
I'm thinking that he's Pastor Gary.
Pastor Gary.
Pastor Jerry.
I don't know. Braxton.
Pastor Gary.
Pastor Gary.
For Rebecca.
What the?
Let it go.
Let it go. Let it go. Can't hold it back anymore. The hot dog song.
God's not dead.
Our God is greater.
Jesus loves me, this I know. For the Bible tells me. Whip, watch me, Nene.
Maddie B. God's not dead, he's surely alive.
God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, rolling like a lion.
Play.
He fixes cars just like my grandpa.
He does the songs. He starts the song, that's it. I don't know anything else.
He videotapes people when they sing.
He's upstairs and he controls all the music and stuff.
Grow a beard.
Worries about his hair.
Sing.
He does stuff all day long if he wants to play all day.
Alabama.
Oklahoma.
Alabama. Oklahoma.
I don't know.
49ers.
Alabama.
Alabama.
Buckeyes.
Buckeyes.
O-H.
I-O. Hey, Alabama. Crimson Tide.
Alabama.
Alabama. Alabama.
Ohio State.
Alabama.
Alabama!
Mom and Dad. We just wanted to tell you that we love you and that we miss you a lot, and that we appreciate your example of leadership, not only in our home, but also in the church as well.
We appreciate the ministry that both of you have done for the last 30 plus years. We love you and we miss you. We wish we were there, but know that we're praying for you always. We hope this day is a blessing for both of you. We love you.
Bye.
As you make your way back to your seat, we're in a continuing worship with the song, Come As You Are. No matter what brokenness, no matter what difficulty you may be facing in your life, you can come to the foot of the cross.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, the rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come near. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your
Well, all right. Eric wasn't kidding when he said that this is the first time I've had jeans on since the eighth grade. That's 56 years ago. Can you imagine that? This is the first time I've had them on, and it's amazing what you'll do to save your job. And, Pastor Al said, buy a pair of jeans and wear them, and if you don't want to buy them, I'll buy them for you, right? Here's the receipt. Ushers, you come on. We're going to take the offering. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all that you've done for us. Bless now the offering, Lord. Thank you for our time of worship. And this is just as much a part of it. And so, Lord, I pray that we might give in accordance to the way that you have blessed us. And, Lord, may the offering be used to bring honor and praise to you. Continue to lead us today. We'll thank you for it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow, kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. And every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. I think about the years I've spent just passing through. I'd like to take the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile and take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of this grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Now I'm just running home into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, God bless the broken road that led me straight.
We're going to go ahead and sing a choir song. This is Pastor Al's, one of his favorite songs. By request, we're going to do it. And it's a great, great song. And it's called Thou, O Lord. And I want to read really quickly here a verse that it comes from in Psalms chapter 3. And just to give a little preface of this song, and it's a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. And it says, Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. Sometimes we feel that way. Sometimes you feel like maybe you're alone, you're hopeless, you're helpless. But the truth is, in verse 3, it says, but thou, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. What's so cool is when we cry out to the Lord, he hears us. He hears the prayers of his faithful ones that cry out to him. I laid me down and slept. I awaked, for the Lord sustained me. I'll not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves against me round about. And so as we sing this song, may that be our prayer. I don't know what you're going through in your life, but may you feel the presence of the Lord, that he's a shield around about you.
broken road. I want to talk with you about that very thing this morning. The broken road. That is the road that God blesses. Take your Bible and find the book of Romans. The book of Romans. We'll look at chapter 8 here in just a moment. And when Paul wrote to the church, the Roman church, he made some astounding claims in the 8th chapter. First, he has said that there is absolutely no condemnation to those of us who are in Christ Jesus. He went on to say that every believer in Jesus Christ through spiritual adoption are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And he has pointed out that every believer enjoys the help and aid of the Holy Spirit as he makes intercession to God for us, expressing to the Father the deepest needs of our heart that cannot be expressed in words. Many of you have been there. You've been there. I've been there. Through our groanings and our moanings, when we can't even get the words out, Jesus makes intercession for us to the Father. Then comes this great statement of Romans 8, 28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. It is though Paul imagines someone saying, Paul, if we as Christians are not condemned, and if we are joint heirs with Christ, and if we have the help of the Holy Spirit, why is it then that we are enduring trouble and sorrow and strain and strife? Why is it that some of the brothers have died and some have been cast into prison and have been scattered and taken from their families? And some have even lost their lives. You see, many of us here today have had or have heartaches right at this very moment. There are a lot of problems in here, a lot of problems, unanswered questions, depression, and discouragement. Perhaps there has come to you this week news of distress. Perhaps there are problems in your family or in your home. Perhaps you are suffering from some marital problems. Maybe from some financial problems. Maybe physical problems. Maybe you just need the Lord to heal you today. You see, there's no doubt that some of these Roman Christians were questioning the providence and the purpose of God. Have you ever done that? Have you ever just questioned even why you're here? Hope that you'll see that reason before we get done today. They question the providence and purpose of God in their lives. So Paul writes to them to say that we have triumph over troubles because God blesses the broken road. So I want us to take a fresh look at this old promise from God's Word, Romans 8, 28. I'll be reading out of the New King James Version today. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. Well, the first thing I want us to see is the promise of the broken road. Now, there are three words that are extremely important in understanding and appreciating what this verse really says. The first word is the word we. Paul says, and we know that all things work together for good. Now, who is the we? We are the ones who love God and who are called. There are only two types of people in this world, and don't forget this. Those who love God and those who don't love God. Not everyone who says they love God truly loves God. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 21, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." In other words, people who truly love God don't just say it, they show it. They do. But we are also the ones who are called. That is, those who love God are the ones whom God has called to be a part of his family and who have responded to that call by surrendering to Jesus Christ and becoming a child of God. Never forget that God's promises are for God's children. That's very important for you to understand this morning. You see, not everybody can say, "Don't worry, everything will work out." You know why? Because everything does not work out for everybody. Everything only works out for God's children. You may be sitting there thinking, "Well, I'm not a child of God, and everything is working out for me." Well, I submit to you that you ultimately will die and spend eternity without God. And you know what? Things really didn't work out for you if you don't know Jesus. Now, the second word is know. Paul says, "And we know that all things work together for good." If you are a Christian today, do you really believe that statement? Can you say, regardless of what I'm going through, how bleak, how bad, how horrible it looks, even though I don't understand it, I know that all things work together for good. You know why? Because I love him. There are a lot of things about God, the Bible, and life we don't know. Paul tells us in verse 26, we don't always know how to pray. Have you ever been there? I couldn't even get the words out again. "Lord, how do I even pray about this? Lord, I just don't understand this. How could you even allow this? I mean, Lord, do you understand? And Lord, my heart is so grieved." Again, Jesus makes intercession to the Father. We don't know what Jesus looks like. We don't know exactly when he's coming back. As a matter of fact, we don't even know what is going to happen in the next 5 minutes. It is dishonest. Now, this is very important, so catch on to this. It is dishonest to claim you don't know what you do know. Everybody with me? It is foolish to claim that you do know what you don't know. But no one should hesitate to claim to know what they do know, and this is one thing you can know. You may not always like what God is doing in your life, and you may not always understand what God is doing in your life. But you can know that God is involved in your life 24/7, making all things work together for your good. This leads to the third word, all. We know that all things work together for good. Now, if Paul would have used the word few, or the word some, or the word most, we would not have batted an eye. But he said, all things work together for good. Now, think about that. This verse did not say, now catch this, this verse did not say that God works all things out for our good most of the time, nor does it say that God works most things out for our good all the time. It says God works all things out together for our good all of the time. Listen, it doesn't say we see all things work together for good. You can't see it sometimes, but you can know it whether you can see it or not. Do you catch that? Just because you can't see it doesn't mean he can't see it. Never, ever doubt in the dark what God has told you in the light. Never. But the question remains, how can this really be true? Well, in my own life, I can tell you, because God has never broken a promise yet. Never. So that is the promise of the broken road. The next thing is the providence of the broken road. Behind every promise of God is the providence of God. Do you know what the word providence means? It comes from two words. The word pro, meaning before, and the word video, meaning to see. Providence simply means to see beforehand and to provide for what is seen. Do you hear that word provide and the word providence? The providence of God simply means that God sees every event before it occurs. Let that sink in. And provides for that event and makes sure that it fits into His plan for your life. Not so much your plan, for His life. His plan for your life. Did you know that there are no accidents in the life of a child of God, just appointments? No accidents, just appointments. So often disappointments are really His appointments. How many times did we go around and we say, man, that was just a divine appointment? Well, what about the times when everything's not going great in your life? What about it? Heard the story of a man who was shipwrecked on a desert island. He managed to get a lot of his little belongings together the best he could. Went over, made a hut to protect those things and himself from the sun after he had had a shipwreck. To protect himself from the sun, the rain, and the wind. He prayed every day that a ship would come by and rescue him, but nothing happened. And one day he decided to go over across the island to gather up some things, to get some food, to check on some things, and come back. And while he was off in the distance, he looked back and he saw smoke. To his dismay, he ran back. He knew he was the only one on the island, to come back and found out that all of his few belongings and the hut was totally gone. God, why are you doing this? I have prayed day after day for somebody to come and save me. Lord, I've lost every possession, and I'm just sleeping here tonight with nothing. And as he woke up the next morning, he heard sounds. And about that time, he looked around, and there was a ship right out there in the water. And he looked up and he saw people. How in the world did you find me? He said, we saw your smoke signal and we decided to come and rescue you. Now let that just sink in for a little bit. Listen, church. God can take a fire and turn it into light that delivers you from darkness. He can take a flood and turn it into a river of blessing. The Greek word for the words work together is the word that gives us the English word synergy. Synergy is what happens when the individual parts of something come together into a whole, thereby having a greater and a better effect than each individual part could have on its own. That's why we have things called better together. Because as a church, you need to understand, we are all better together. Think about it this way. Every moment of every day is one individual piece of the puzzle of God's plan for your life. Do you realize that you have circumstances, I know, going on in your life right now? And God can reach into that bag of circumstances on any given day with His eyes shut, pull out any piece, and make it fit in the puzzle of his plan for you perfectly. Now, that does not mean that all things that happen to us are good. As you well know, everything that happens to you is not good. But everything that happens to you will ultimately work together for your good. Many of you in here today are going through things. I dare to say that there's no telling how many of you have lost a baby. Whether it was a miscarry, whether it was at birth, like my sister, stillborn. But mid-July, my oldest daughter, who's married, been trying to get married for 18 months, it was a Wednesday evening, right before we went to eat. She FaceTimed us, and there she was, all excited, told us, me and Lori, she was pregnant. And she said, but please pray that my progesterone levels will be up. I go to the doctor on Monday. That was the same week that I was getting ready when we was doing an Unclaimed Baggage series. I was getting ready to preach on fear. And I feared that this could happen. So I preached on fear that day. And then on Monday, I got that blood-curdling scream. Lori was working. She called, Daddy, and told me that she had miscarried. That next Sunday, coming up Sunday, I was preaching on depression. God's amazing, isn't he? But do you realize today that God has a plan for her life? God's ways are not our ways most of the time, right? And you need to understand his way is perfect. When I was a little boy, I used to watch my mother bake cakes. My mother is 86 and she's literally forgotten how to cook today. But nobody in this world makes a better pound cake than my mom. In fact, nobody really makes much anything better than my mom, okay? And I'm very honest with my wife. Look, nobody cooks like my mom. I go to Lori's house, her mother cannot cook like my mom, you understand? I'm just that straightforward about it. But you know what? Have you ever tried to eat Crisco by itself? Huh? Yeah. Have you ever tasted a little bit of flour by itself? Even vanilla flavoring. And so you think about all that, right? Well, you know, all those are ingredients. Raw eggs, I've drank them before trying to be Rocky to make a commercial when I was a student pastor. They're awful. Any of those things by themselves, not only do I not like them, but they are very harmful and very dangerous. But she would take those ingredients, mix them together, put them into the oven, and out come the greatest pound cake you had ever eat in your life. You see, it's not what goes into the bowl that matters. It is what comes out of the oven that counts. Now, you are not always going, hear this, to enjoy the ingredients. Never, most of the time, that God put into the recipe of your life. Listen to me. When he is finished baking it, you will have Romans 8:28 cake, and the taste will be unbelievable. Did you know that every day, most all of us consume 2 deadly poisons? By themselves, they are called sodium and chloride. Now, either one taken alone can kill you. But taken together, they form sodium chloride, otherwise known as salt. Either one without the other can poison you. But when they're put together, they can bless you. Amen? If a human being can take 2 things that are bad and make them into something good, surely, surely you believe that our God can take everything that is bad and make it into good. Amen? Do you remember the story of Joseph? Joseph was one of the most godly young men who ever lived. Joseph was the favorite son of Jacob, but his brothers were jealous. And one day, you know, they betrayed him, put him in a pit, sold him into slavery. For every day, he was walking around, and I'm sure he had all these thoughts running through his mind. But far away from the love of his father, he no longer was a favored son, but became a slave performing menial tasks. To make things worse, he refused to commit adultery with Potiphar's wife. He was thrown into prison. There he was in prison, and perhaps he began to think, now what possible purpose could God have in all of this? Well, we would say to him, now watch this. Cheer up, Joseph. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord. He would reply, that may be true, but I can't see it now. But Joseph's humiliation simply prepared the way for his advancement. And Joseph, through interpreting the dreams of the Pharaoh, became the greatest man in Egypt. And because he was in great power, he was able to save an entire nation, including his own family. And here's what Joseph said to his brothers. Now, what I would say to mine, I am about to behead you for selling me into slavery. Okay? But here's Joseph in chapter 50, verse 20. But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it for good. Listen, it didn't seem good when it was happening to Joseph, but God worked it for good. Listen, you've got junk going on in your life right now. I know that. You know why? Because you're a human being. It's junk to you. But everything has to go through God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit to even get to you. And if God allows it, I shared this with my men's Bible study group. I probably shared it here twice in my 3 years as pastor, but what my mother gave me when I was 17 years old. Listen, there is no trouble, no testing, or any circumstance that can ever touch me until it has first gone past God, then through to Christ, then right through to me. But I refuse to become panicky as I lift up my eyes and realize if it has come this far, it must have come as some purpose of blessing to my own heart. Do you understand? If God allows it, He has a plan. Has somebody betrayed you? Has somebody lied about you? Has somebody falsely accused you? Have you been serving God and yet everything doesn't seem to turn out right? Then here's the question. Are you willing to write Romans 8:28 over that today? Do you understand that as a child of God, nothing can happen to you that God cannot turn for your good and His glory? God is not a creature by chance. Things have a meaning and a purpose. You remember the story of Moses and how Moses, when he was a babe, his mother, Jochebed, hit him in the bulrushes just at the time the princes of Egypt was going down for a bath in the river. There she was with her entourage in the Nile River. And the Bible says, lo, the baby wept. Just a little cry of a baby. But the destiny of a nation hinged on the cry of that baby. You see, God is so great that not a sparrow falls without His knowledge. Even the hairs on our head are numbered. When God says that all things work together for good, all of life has a purpose for the child of God. That's what that means. The promise, the providence, and lastly, the purpose of the broken road. You say, Pastor, I would love to understand the promises of God, and I do understand that God makes promises. And I can understand the providence, but really, what is the purpose of all this? What is even the purpose of life? God's purpose for you, we're told here, is good. God's purpose for you is that the end result of your entire life will be to the good. Now, that does not mean that things will turn out like you think they should. And it may seem that certain things that are bad at the time, listen, really are good. Now, good does not necessarily mean health, because not all Christians are healthy. It does not necessarily mean wealth, because not all Christians are wealthy. God's purpose for you is neither to be healthy or happy, nor to be rich or famous. His purpose for you is found in verse 29, and here it is, where Paul said, we have been predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. God's purpose for you is to be like His Son, Jesus Christ. There it is. It is to be like Jesus. The best thing that can ever happen to you in this life is not to make millions of dollars, nor become famous, nor to live in a mansion, nor to drive a Mercedes. The best thing that can ever happen to you in this life is to become just like Jesus. When they saw Peter and all them, you know what I mean? They couldn't even speak because they could tell that they had been with Jesus. When is the last time someone looked at you and said, I can see it now. You have been with Jesus. What is His purpose? To make us like Jesus Christ. Sometimes sweet things do it. Sometimes sorrowful things do it. Sometimes sinful things do it. Sometimes satanic things do it. Sometimes simple things do it. God is working all things together for good to them that love God, for them who are called according to His purpose, and His purpose is to make you and me like Jesus Christ. So let me close. This message is God's way of calling you. This message is God's way of saying to you, I love you. I not only have a plan for your life, but I have a purpose for your life. I want to save you, and I will save you if you'll trust me. Now, only God knows what is good for you. What is good is not necessarily what you think is best, but I can tell you that God's good is always better than your best. Many of you may be in here this morning. You just need to take your hands off the wheel and let Jesus take it. And you don't even need to get in the passenger seat or the back seat, but you need to get in a trunk and lock it up and say, Jesus, the best I know how, I surrender everything I have to you. Lord, even though I don't understand it, even though I'm not thrilled about it, Father, I know in my heart that you have more important things for me than I could ever fathom. Lord, you love me more than I could ever love myself. Lord, you know my family is falling apart. Lord, you know my marriage is struggling. Lord, you know we're hurting financially. Lord, you know my health is not where it should be. But Lord, I do know you, if you do, and I love you, and I believe that you work all things together for the good. If you're here today, boy, you just need to come and maybe surrender some things to God. Just ask God to help you. You don't have to understand it. Just trust Him. If you're here today and you don't know the Lord, today is the day of salvation. There'll be pastors down front. Just come. We'd love to pray with you. Whatever your need is today, God blesses the broken road. Father, today I would ask that you would touch people today, Lord, like you've never touched them before. God, there are so many people here today who are going through things that I don't even understand. Lord, maybe I couldn't understand if they told me, but God, you do. Lord, I pray today that you would help people to surrender their worries, that God, they would cast all their cares upon you.